Good morning, good morning, good morning, and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank God for allowing us to be here this morning, all these beautiful faces. This is Palm Sunday, everybody. Woo! This is Palm Sunday. And we come nothing else but to praise and to worship God as we go into prayer this morning. Would everyone please stand for prayer? If you are able, please stand for prayer. Father God, we thanking you this day, Lord God. Father, we thanking you for allowing us to be back in this house one more time, Lord God, to bow down before you, Lord God, to praise and worship you, Lord God, for allowing us to come down through another week, Lord God. Father God, and kept us from all hurt, harm, and danger, Lord God. Father, we ask you to touch right now this morning, Lord God, to usher in your spirit in this house, in this place, Lord God. Touch every soul that enter these doors, Lord God, that they not go out in the way they came in. Drench every heart this morning, Lord God. Remember those that are homeless outdoors, those that are sick, those that are afflicted, Lord God, those that are going through addiction, Lord God, those that are fighting right now, Lord God. Father God, we ask that you touch right now, Lord God, on the pastor, the bishop, the elder this morning, Lord God. Father God, as the word go forth this morning, that it fall on heart, that it prick and convict souls this morning, Lord God. Touch on the man of God in this house this morning, Lord God. Drench him with a word, Lord God. Father, for the homeless this morning, Lord God. Touch somebody this morning, Lord God. We asking you to go through the hospital, nursing home, institution this morning, Lord God. Touch on the sick and ill, Lord God, the doctor's hands, Lord God. Father God, asking you to move over this world, Lord God. Father God, as we see time approaching, Lord God, and we see every amount of sin and wickedness upon the face of this earth, Lord God. Father God, we ask that you touch right now in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord God. And Father God, we be careful to give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' mighty name. Are you ready to worship? Are you ready to worship? I woke up this morning, I've been singing this little song. I told the musician when Pastor called me, it was at the last minute. I'm standing in for Sister Keisha. We're going to remember her in prayer and all of those in their absentee. But I woke up this morning around 5:30 and my heart was just, I had went through so much this week, but God just started lightening in the load this morning. And I woke up with this little song and I'm going to share it with you. This morning when I rose, yeah, I didn't have no doubt. This morning when I rose, y'all, I didn't have no doubt. This morning when I rose, yeah, I didn't have no doubt. I know the Lord would take care of me. I know the Lord would prepare me. He will carry me all the way. This morning when I got out of bed, I didn't have no doubt. This morning when I got out of bed, y'all, I didn't have no doubt. This morning when I got out of bed, I didn't have no doubt. Y'all know what? I knew the Lord would take care of me. I know the Lord will provide for me. He will carry me all the way. This morning when I rose, yeah, I didn't have no doubt. This morning when I rose, y'all, I didn't have no doubt. Hey, this morning when I rose, yeah, I didn't have no doubt. I know the Lord would take care of me. I know the Lord would provide for me. Oh, knew the Lord would take care of me. He took care of me. He was at me all the day. Oh, yes, amen, amen. Did anybody have a doubt this morning? I thank God at this time. We thank God for the as we prepare for our announcement by our very own Sister Kim.
Good morning, great morning, family. Great morning. Yes, Lord, we are so grateful. So our weekly services are as follow. On Tuesday, we have the Power Out of Prayer. Is anybody a part of that prayer service on Tuesdays? Can anybody testify that we're moving things throughout the week through our prayer call? Hallelujah. So we invite you guys to join us every Tuesday at the noonday hour. The prayer call is held by our very own Mother Faye Chambers. And on Wednesday, listen, you don't have to go throughout the week hungry in the spirit. You can stop by our dynamic discipleship Bible study held at the hours of 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. So if you don't mind joining us Tuesdays and Wednesday, we greatly appreciate it. To know more about our upcoming events and services, please go to thechurchofjesus.org. Again, that is thechurchofjesus.org. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. 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 This is the day that the Lord has made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, it's Palm Sunday. Hosanna. Y'all must have been in my prayer time this morning. God is good, and I find no fault in him. Amen? Amen? Can somebody give me a palm branch? I think they had one up here for me, but, you know, I feel like, thank you, thank you. Y'all replace that. Give her one more, because she's worshiping. She's waving. Come on, somebody. It's Palm Sunday. It's Palm Sunday. Look at somebody and say, the King is here. Oh, y'all don't want to say it. The King is here. Whether you realize it or not, the King is here. I want to welcome everybody that's joining us online this morning, those that are here in the house. Good to see you. Mother, it's good to see you. We've been talking and praying. And Mother has, let me tell you, she inspires me. You know, when I call to check on Mother each week or every other week, and she get to ministering to me, and I said, Lord, have mercy. I said, Mother, hold on, wait a minute. I'm supposed to call and encourage you. She said, I know, Pastor. But isn't it good to have seasoned saints in the house of God? Amen? Isn't it good to have prayer warriors in the house of God? Isn't it good to have somebody you can reach out to and just have a conversation and know that whatever you talk about, come on, somebody, they're not judging, they're praying. Amen. Hosanna. 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 While y'all marinate on that word a little bit, it's time for our offering. It's offering time. It's offering time. It's offering time. And we want to give you an opportunity before we get too far into the service to be able to give. Amen. If you need an envelope, just slip your hand up. The ushers will be glad to serve you. Those that are watching us online, just click the give button. The information is there for you. There's the drop-down menu that if you're giving your tithe, you can select that. If you're giving an offering, you can select that, or first fruits, or giving toward the building fund, you know, you can select that as well. Amen. We will be starting our renovation back this week. I'm so glad of that. I was talking with the general contractor this week, and they was finishing up some other things. And so this week we're back on schedule to begin starting up renovation again downstairs. Amen. I'm so excited about that because nothing just happens. Nothing just happens. And let us remember Sister Keisha this morning, our worship leader. She's under the weather. She's not doing well. So just pray for her, amen? Continue to pray for her and her family. There are so many others, God, that, you know, Mother Sister Maylane and Mother Thornton and her family, Mother Chambers, and several of you and those that are watching us online, you know, perhaps you are experiencing or have experienced a death in your family or maybe a financial crisis or something like that. But I just want to just take a moment to tell you that God knows about your trouble. And God is here to help you. And what I mean by when I say he's here, he's not just in these four walls of the church. Come on, somebody. He's in your house. God is in your house. The Spirit of God is in your house. Amen? But this is the key. You got to activate it. You have to activate it. And so as you prepare your giving, your tithe, and your offering, next week is Resurrection Sunday, and we usually have on Good Friday, we usually meet here for 1 hour. But because of the renovation that's going to be going on, I'm going to ask you to join me on your own time between the hours of 9 and 1. If you would just fast and pray. And whatever you, this is between you and God, whatever you decide to give up, that's between you and God. But I'm just asking you for those 4 hours between 9 and 1 o'clock. If you just join me in that time of fasting and prayer. I know some of you will be at work and working and like myself, you know, but just as you do your work, just remember to pray, right? And whatever you decide to give up, that's between you and the Lord. But let's just be on one accord on Good Friday, amen? Let's just be on one accord for those 4 hours that we just come together in unity and to go after God. Amen? There's so much that I know that God is doing in this ministry and the transition that we're making in this ministry. God is up to something. And one thing that I realize that God don't want us to become status quo. He don't want us to become complacent. See, we can have a routine and become comfortable in that routine, but then God upset the apple cart, as they say. Come on, somebody. So if you're going through something, and if it's something that, oh Lord, where's this come from? Don't worry about it. God is just saying, hey, you have been praying, you have been fasting, you have been asking, but now I want to just take you through the test. Are you going to trust me? Are you going to trust me? When we give to the house of the Lord, God is still saying, are you going to trust me? Are you going to trust me? What it's going to take for us to finish this building, it's going to total a little over $30,000. That's not a lot of money when you really think about it. But when you have other obligations, come on, somebody. When you have other obligations, and you're like, Lord, how you gonna do this? But I speak it in faith, and y'all heard me say it. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, in me. Amen? So we have to activate that power that's within us. We have to activate the things that God has gifted us with. Oh, we gonna be debt free and gonna stay debt free. Come on, somebody. So you have to speak. You have to speak that in your own life. Amen. So as we go through the transformation of the building, each phase, we're gonna stroke that check, and then the next phase is gonna start. And when they finish that, we're gonna write that check. Come on, somebody. This is God's house. And what we make happen for his house, he'll make happen for our house. I'm not telling you something I think. I'm telling you something I know. Amen? God is a good God. And I find no fault in him. No fault in him. Are you ready to give this morning? Come on, stand up on your feet. We always like to speak our declaration back to the Lord. And that's just giving him thanks and just recognizing what he has done and what he's going to do. Amen? Raise those envelopes or raise your hand or your mobile device or whatever, however you have given this morning or this week. And repeat this back after me. Lord, I come before you today, presenting my time, talents, and treasures back to you in faith. I believe your word, and I honor your word by putting my faith in action through giving. Father, I thank you for your blessings, and I believe I will have what you promised, in Jesus' name. Come on, somebody, give God a hand clap of praise. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Come on, somebody. Wave those palm branches. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. We come into his presence with singing, praising, worshiping. Huh? Come on. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Boy, come on, somebody. Oh, oh. Come on, watch this. Follow me. Follow me. Follow me. Get on one accord. Oh, 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 magnify the Lord, for he's worthy to be praised. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he's worthy to be praised. Hosanna, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Of my salvation. Let's sing it again. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Come on. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he Oh, y'all sound good. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he, isn't he worthy to be praised? Come on, Hosanna, come on. He is the rock. Blessed be. Magnify the Lord, for he, isn't he worthy? Think about it. Watch this, watch this. Be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Come on. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be. He's the rock of my salvation. Somebody, give him a hand clap of praise. He is the rock. Oh, blessed be the rock. Blessed. Let me hear you say. Let me hear you say. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. He's the rock of my. He's the rock of my salvation. Blessed be. Blessed be the rock. Yeah. Blessed be. Come on, somebody. Blessed be the rock. Yeah. Come on. He is the foundation of everything that we have. Every place that we go, everything that we do, he is the rock of my salvation. He is the foundation of everything. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Come on, 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 come on. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, 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 come on. Enter in, enter in, enter in. Worship, 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 worship. Worship, 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 worship. Yeah. Worship, 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 worship. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Is he your rock? I say, is he your rock? Is he your rock? Come on, come on, come on, come on. See, you got to make it real in your life. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Lord, I think these little babies are praising. If you don't praise them, the babies are going to praise them. Come on, somebody. Yeah. Come on. It's just that. Blessed be the rock. 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 Rock of my salvation. Rock of my soul. Blessed be the rock. See, I don't know about you, but tell somebody, the king is here. The king is here. The king is here. The king is here. It's Palm Sunday. And Listen. And he's coming in, not like you expected, but he's coming in on a donkey, the least, the most insignificant, because you don't expect him to come in, the Savior, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords. So you're expecting him to come in on the white horse. But he said, no, not yet. Not yet. Huh? But he's coming in, riding on a donkey. Woo-hoo! The King. Look at somebody, say the King of Kings. The Lords of Lords. Take it from the top. Come on, bless it, bless it, bless it, bless it, bless it, bless it, bless it. Oh, magnify the Lord. I can't get away from it. For he is worthy to be. Listen, I know we're supposed to go on, but oh, magnify the Lord. For he, King of Kings, Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Come on, Hosanna. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Oh, magnify. Come on, give him praise. Let me hear you say it. Let me hear you say it. Hosanna, blessed be. Oh, that's a beautiful choir singing. Oh, magnify the Lord. Y'all got it? Come on, y'all got it. He is worthy to. Oh, magnify. For this is the part that I love. Hosanna, blessed be. Blessed be. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he, isn't he worthy? Oh, magnify, magnify. Hosanna, blessed be. Thank you. Oh, magnify. For he. For he. Listen. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Are you ready for the word? Are you ready for the word? The word is going to cut you. Y'all ain't saying nothing. It's going to cut you. Huh? but that's all right. When it cuts you, God is standing right here to just heal you up anyway. Huh? Are you ready for the word? See, y'all say y'all be ready for the word, but then all of a sudden the word come, and you be like, oh, Lord, I'm bleeding right there. Oh, come on, somebody. She done stepped on my toes. That's all right. Because if you don't go through anything, how you going to know God can heal you? If you don't go through anything, how do you know God can be a way maker? If you don't go through anything, how do you know God can bring you out? If you don't go through anything, how do you know God is a healer? He's a way maker. He's a burden bearer. He's a mind regulator. So stop complaining. And allow the word of God. Let it cut you. But he's also going to heal you. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Are you ready for the word? Are you ready for the word? I'm going to introduce to some and present to others. Our dear sister, Sister Kim Mathis. Come on. Give her a hand clap of praise. Come on.
Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Stand to your feet. We're not getting tired today. Today is Palm Sunday. Do you understand the significance of this day? This is the day that, you know, that we reverence Jesus Christ. And it was around this time he was getting ready to head to the cross. And he found it not robbery for you and I to come in on a donkey. You know, we get all fine and all up in our, all just snooty. We ride in our Lexus and we ride in a Mercedes and, you know, all these finer cars. But the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords came in on a donkey. Hallelujah. So this ain't the time to keep quiet. Hallelujah. Is he your rock? Does anybody know that the Lord is your rock? Hallelujah. All other ground is sinking sand. I know for him to be my solid foundation. Amen. 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 Lord God, we give you glory today. And I'm going to ask the people of God if you just stand one more time. We about to pray and we about to sit down at the table and feast on God's word. Is that all right with you all? And I won't be before you too long. But God, we honor you today. Father, we come to give you glory, honor, and praise. Lord God, it is Palm Sunday. This is where the people that were spectators of Jesus Christ in the flesh, and they stood to the side of the road and they put down palm leaves and cried, Hosanna, Hosanna, God of hope. It was in Jesus Christ that they put their hope in. Today, March 24, 2024, we're still putting our hope in you, God. We're still putting our hope in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so, God, we are so grateful to be amongst the land of the living today, God. To be in your presence, hallelujah. Because, God, we know that it is a privilege to be in your presence. And it is an honor, God, to stand before your holy throne, God. And so, Father, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to call out, to have an audible voice to cry, Hosanna, blessed be the rock. And so, God, I ask that you lay hands upon this word just as you have given it to me. Let it edify the people of God. Lord God, we're looking to elevate in you, Father. So let this word be a foundation that moves us up and up and up in you, God, in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, as I take the back seat, Holy Spirit, you drive. And so, God, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. If you don't mind, remain standing for the reading of God's word real quick. It's a real quick scripture, but I'm telling you, it's a powerful scripture. So turn over with me, if you will, to Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 12. And when you got it, say amen. If you need a little bit more time, just say wait on me. All right, y'all ready? All right. Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 12. Ready? We're going to read it together. Y'all ready? Read. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of sound of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Most High God. And I want to talk to you today from the title, God's Word, Our Weapon. Turn to your neighbor and say, God's word, our weapon. Turn to your other neighbor and say, God's word, your weapon. Point to yourself, say, God's word, my weapon. So if I asked you prior to today, before hearing the title of this message, I ask you, what is God's word to you? Now, this question is just a little bit different from what God's word mean to you. But if you could put it best in your own words, would you be able to explain to someone else, whether they're a believer or a non-believer, what is God's word to you? And I can imagine what some of your answers may be. Something like, his word is a sustainer. It keeps me focused on this Christian journey. Someone else might say that his word is spiritual nourishment unto my hungry and thirsty soul, as it says over in Psalm 63. Amen? I believe if you ask the Bible scholar, they would make mention of Psalm chapter 119, verse number 105, to say that thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So I have to admit to you, family, that none of the answers that I just mentioned or the answers that I did not mention, none of them are incorrect. But today, family, I want to talk to you about the word being your weapon against anything that is against God and his nature in this fallen world. Y'all ready? All right, look at your neighbor and say, his word will cut you. Turn to your other neighbor and say, his word is sharp. So as believers of Christ, whose faith is solely on the life, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God's word is more than just a passage of scriptures, if you will. It's more than a passage of scriptures as times before, but his word today is the most powerful weapon that exists. And as the body of Christ, it's time that we understand the magnitude of the power that we have in his word. So make no mistake about it. God's word is not dead. Anybody agree with that? God's word is alive and well. Can anybody agree with that? Hallelujah. We don't serve a dead God, and his word is not dead. So even today, the word of God is sharper than it was over 2,000 years ago. That's why we as Christians can speak with a level of authority, because God's word is alive and it backs us up. That's why I'm quick to tell anybody, listen, you don't have to argue the word of God. You don't have to have heated debates about the word of God, because the word of God speaks for itself. But see, what has the body of Christ in a chokehold is that we expect for the world to believe that you and I, we have authority, and that the word of God has power. But see, it's hard for the world to believe this because they're seeing something different in the Christian nation today.
There are many who confess that they are Christians. They are of the Christian faith. But when the gaze of the world is upon that person, their lives contradicts what the word of God says. So before we move further, let's go back and I'm going to read this scripture for y'all one more time, if you will. And we'll move forward in what the message God has given me for his people. It says, for the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the hearts. The word of God ain't no joke. Not only do it pierce the joint, do you know how hard the joints are, the bones that connect in the joint? Do you know how hard that is? Like the joints are hard, but the word of God will cut through the joints and the marrows of us. So I want you guys to use your imagination with me, if you will, all right? Think about the Renaissance movies. Anybody like medieval movies, all of the swords and all that back in the day? Anybody? I'm not a fan of those movies, but so y'all know what I'm talking about. Look, brothers, yeah, that's me right there. I love those movies. All right. So just think about those particular movies back in the day. Now I want you to put this image in your mind. You see two men fighting. And back in those days, one of the weapons of choice is the sword, right? And so we know that our regular sword, it has a handle at the end. But use your mind, if you will. Just think about what the word of God says, a two-edged sword. Imagine these two men that are fighting, trying to hold on to a two-edged sword. They're fighting. And it makes it difficult for them to fight because in the time that they're using the sword, they're getting wounded as well because it's a double-edged sword. And as it's defending them, it's also cutting them. But when it comes to the word of God, the two-edged sword, one end is to cut the head off the enemy, and the other end of the sword is to prune you and I as the children of God. Amen? So you might ask, what do you mean by pruning? First, let me tell you what pruning means. It means to cut away the dead and overgrown branches or stems. This is done to increase fruitfulness and growth. We all need pruning. So this means that the other end of the sword is here to shape our lives. It says over in John chapter 15, verse number 5, Jesus says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Amen. So we're going to need some pruning. For without me, you can do nothing. Come on here, John 1:1. What does it say? In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. So if we are connected to the vine, which is Jesus Christ, and as believers we are to bear fruit, then therefore you and I, we cannot be offended when we read the word of God and it begins to prick our hearts. That's only the vine dresser shaping us. That's only the vine dresser pruning us. That means God must love us. If his word is here to shape us, amen? So his word is like a surgical knife. It cuts precisely. His word performs surgery on our heart. It cuts the sin, the errors of ways that's not pleasing unto him. His word operates on the ill parts that are within us, that are harmful to our soul. You see, the word of God, it etches out the things that are within us that could very well rot out the core of our spiritual being. It can rot out the core of our spiritual fruit. So it's more to it than just reading the Bible. We have to open up the word of God and allow it to mold us and shape us. For Isaiah 64:8
says that, for he is the potter and we are the clay. But see, with the sharpness of God's word piercing our hearts, it comes with us making the decision to obey the word. That's where a lot of Christians are falling short. The Bible is putting away the things that feels good to the flesh. So you and I, we got to make a decision to follow the word of God in its entirety, not just to pick out the parts that make us feel good. That's not what God's word is for. And you know, most of us, we have lived long enough to know just because it feels good don't mean that it's good. Amen. If it goes against God's word, but it's pleasing to the flesh, you set yourself up to become a puppet of the enemy. So how many of you know that allowing God's word to shape you, to shape me, that his word is actually here to save us from the gates of hell? If you ask somebody out here in this world that has yet to understand the love of Christ, they will tell you that the word of God is just a bunch of religious rules to keep you from living life to the fullest. And that this religion was created by a particular race. But I have now come to understand that it's these types of answers is a response from a person that's not ready to stop living in the flesh. They're allowing their flesh to lead them. They're only being led in the broad way that the Bible speaks about. And who's the ruler of that broad way? The word of God is our weapon from eternal damnation. And it's sad to see how many people have turned away from God's word only to be led to a life of deception. You see, Satan has become a bit witty, if you will, because he knows that the word of God is powerful. Ain't it sad that Satan knows that the word is more powerful than a lot of Christians? He knows that the word holds power. But see, some of us are very unsure about the power that the word of God actually has. So Satan will convince you that, oh, yeah, it's okay to live in an alternative lifestyle because Jesus loves you. He'll tell you that it's okay to live a life of adultery after making a covenant with God as husband and wife. He'll tell you that money will solve all of your problems, so by any means necessary, you need to secure the bag. But what I have found, 2020, it has opened up my eyes. A lot of people out here trying to secure the bag, and they have yet to secure their soul in Christ. So their soul is out here abandoned like an orphan, while the flesh is chasing something that is fleeting and temporary. Amen? So that which the word speaks, it's up to you and I to make a decision to not only hear his word, but to do his word. You see, God's word is love. It's a weapon of protection for our soul. Anybody know that? You see, if God didn't love us unconditionally, he wouldn't send his only son to the cross to be the propitiation for our sins today. But one thing I know about God, he allows you and I free will. So if we decide to go against his word, then he has already said that he will give us over to a reprobate mind. And reprobate is just another word for an unprincipled mind. You see, a reprobate mind is a mind that is in agreement with the enemy. A mind that says that God's word can perform surgery on my heart and so that I can follow him, but I choose not to go through his holy surgical procedure. I just want to live.
God knows that all of us won't be Bible scholars, but he made his words so clear that we don't have to guess or we don't have to wonder what's right or wrong. His word is laid out very clear. And I don't know about you. I know that I haven't been saved all my life. Anybody else? But I knew when I was out in the street that I knew God. And I knew enough about his word that when I was out doing wrong, when I was out skinning and grinning, as the old saints say, when I was allowing my flesh to have its way, when this was happening, that's when the word of God was piercing me the most. I wasn't comfortable with what I was doing. I was reminded that my body is a temple unto the Lord and that I'm a living sacrifice, that my words should be seasoned with salt so I can't go out here and cuss everybody out. I knew the word. I knew better. And I've shared this story with you guys. When I was younger, my Aunt Geneva and Uncle Roosevelt, they would come and pick me up at 7 in the morning to go to church, y'all. Y'all heard this. Don't understand why, still to this day. But they did it. And we would head over to Mount Gilead Baptist Church over in Vine City. And, y'all, I would be the first child there. I could have ate like 6 bowls of cereal before the next child even entered into the church. And so back when you're 5, 6, 7 years old, it seems like church took all day to end, right? You get out of church, it's 50 o'clock. We done been in church all day. I mean, y'all, we would get there at 7 in the morning. We leave Mount Gilead till about 3 in the afternoon. And although I didn't understand at that time, honestly, I do understand now that through the course of those long Sundays, it was putting something on the inside of me that made me one day uncomfortable with living a sinful lifestyle. As I got older and started reading God's word, the day came when I understood that I'm living a lukewarm lifestyle. And I better get it together before God's grace and mercy expires on me. You see, God's word, sharper than any two-edged sword. That means his word should penetrate our hearts, right? And if it doesn't penetrate the heart, it's not God's word that's the issue. The Bible said that's an issue of the heart. That's a hardened heart. And I now understand what Joshua 1:8 says when he mentions that thou shouldn't meditate on the word of God day and night. And it's possible for someone to just read the Bible and not get an understanding. Like they just flip through the pages like it's a fictional book. But how many of you know that the word of God is here for us to understand and to dive deep in the word? But I've seen people give more reverence to books like 50 Shades of Grey. Come on, saints, y'all know what 50 Shades of Grey is. Or Terry McMillan books. But if you ask them what the Holy Spirit has put down on the inside of them about a scripture, they can't even tell you. But they can sure enough tell you about Christopher in 50 Shades of Grey. And I like to tell y'all that it's an exaggeration what I'm saying, but it's true. And see, even today, there's a lot of people who have put down the physical books, and we have the audible books. We have our cell phones. Lord, have mercy. Help us, Jesus. And they can tell you all about social media. They can tell you about how to beat the algorithm so you can get the likes. They can tell you about everything that goes viral, but that Bible app has been untouched for quite some time. But then we wonder why there's so much spiritual warfare in the atmosphere. When God's word is our blueprint, it don't just tell us how to fight and conquer spiritual warfare, but the word of God converts into a weapon. Amen, somebody. That when you come in contact with the spirit of opposition, you can stand boldly and declare that the word of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, is your strength, and that no weapon formed against you shall prosper, and that every tongue that rises up against you in judgment, you shall condemn.
So you can declare that God gives you the power to trample the serpent's head. You can stand 10 toes down and tell the principalities that come against you that God has not given you the spirit of the fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. So the word of God not only gives you discernment of what you're fighting against, but the word also discerns the good and the bad that is within us. So no matter how much a person tries to deny it, the word of God always have a way of pointing out the flaws that are within us. The spirit of pride, the spirit of greed, the spirit of envy, the spirit of lust, a double mind, the religious spirit. There's a lot of that today. The spirit of anger, spirit of deceit. But if you allow the word of God to do surgery on you, I promise you that your spiritual bill of health will never be of a bad report. That's what the double-edged sword does. Again, it's not here to harm us, but it's here to prune us. Anybody all right with being pruned by that double-edged sword? You see, one thing about it, though, we can't deny that we reap benefits when we allow the word to do what it does in our life. Can anybody testify that God's pruning with his two-edged sword comes with many blessings that we can't count? So it's more than just a bunch of rules, as the world says. That's our basic instruction before leaving earth. And those that are without it, unfortunately, eternal damnation is on the other side. God's word tells us who we are and who we are not. You see, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 19 through 20 says that you are not your own. You were bought with a price. John 15 and 19 says you are not of the world. But I have chosen you out of the world. Therefore, the world hates you. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse number 13 says that you are not the tail, you are not beneath, and you are not the borrower. Galatians 5 and 7 says that we are no longer slaves to sin. Amen? God's double-edged sword. It also tells you what we are. Romans 8:37 says that we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Romans 8 and 17 says that we are heirs of God and joint heirs of Jesus Christ. Somebody should have got excited right then and there. 1 John 3 and 1 says that we are the children of God. Ephesians 2 and 10 says we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Sharper than any two-edged sword. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says that when we are in Christ, we are a what? New creature. Need I say more? Well, don't mind if I do then. 1 Peter 2 and 9 says that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. John 15 and 15 says that we are friends of Jesus. Should I keep going? 2 Corinthians 2 and 14 tells us that we are triumphant. Somebody needed to hear that today. Turn to your neighbor and say, I am triumphant. Turn to your other neighbor and say, I am triumphant. Colossians 2 and 10 says that in him we have been made complete. The word of God is so sharp that it will cut us down. But it's powerful enough to build us back up. Hello, somebody. God's word is life-changing. The word of God draws us closer to him. It brings out the error of our ways and sets us upon his solid foundation through Jesus Christ. The word of God teaches us how to worship God in spirit and in truth. It's in his word that we know how to love our enemies. Yeah, I know that's hard.
those that wrongfully use us, abuse us, and ain't got one bit of remorse about it. But it's in his word where he tells us not to render eye for an eye or a tooth for a tooth. But guess what? Vengeance belongs to our Father in heaven. So we need not to respond. We have the two-edged sword. God's word is backing us, so we don't have to get back with the word, the world. We got the word backing us up. So remember what Ephesians 6 and 12 says. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against what? Principalities. Come on, Bible scholars. Principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So I have a question for you, saints. Who's the ruler of darkness? Come on, say it loud. Act like you know. So when the principality comes against you, when Satan is coming against your children, when he has come again in your household and tried to take over, and he come and put his nasty, stinking feet up under your dinner table, when he has come against your mind with his lies and attacked your health, baby, you better pull out that two-edged sword and get to slicing and dicing the enemy, his lies, and his foot soldiers. You stand back and you say Ephesians 6 and 11, I got on my full armor of God, so I stand against the schemes of the adversary. You tell him James 4 and 7, I have submitted myself to the Most High God. So Satan, you got to flee. You tell him 1 Peter 5 and 8, devil, I know that you prowl like a roaring lion, seeking somebody to devour. Well, I ain't the one. I'm sober-minded. I'm watchful. So you better back up off of me. You tell them Luke 10 and 19, God has given me the authority to trample upon your head, enemy. You bet find you something safe to do. I'm a child of God, and I got on my full arm of God, and I'm strapped with the two-edged sword. Turn to your neighbor and ask him, are you strapped? Turn to your other neighbor and say, we going to war against the adversary. So you tell the spirit of darkness, I'm backed by the word of God. You see, Deuteronomy tells us that, yeah, the enemy going to run up on you. He going to come one way. But I guarantee you, like the big joker in a deck of cards, he may come at you one way, but he gonna flee seven ways. That's why you got to have that double-edged sword. Matthew 18, verses 18 through 20 says that whatever I bind on earth shall be bound up in heaven. And whatever I loose on earth, it shall be loosed in heaven. So if I have another soldier of God and we agree, whatever we ask for, it will be done for us by our Father in heaven. For where two or more are gathered, God is in the midst. You want me to make it make a little bit more sense? All right. You ain't even got to say it. Deuteronomy 32 and 30 says, one can put 1,000 to flight, two 10,000. Amen. I like God's math. That means me and my prayer partner, we strapped with a double-edged sword, and we waging war against the enemy and all his foot soldiers, and we taking his head off. Hear me real clear, saints. It matters who you have praying and fighting with you. When it's time to go to war against spiritual wickedness, you don't need nobody that ain't certain about their faith in Christ and in his word. You don't need no fence straddlers. You don't need no timid soldiers. You don't need no, and I said you don't need, that's right, mm-hmm. You don't need no universe worshipers, no idolaters, because the enemy knows that his time is almost up. So he's doing anything in his power to defeat the believers of Jesus Christ. And he's doing his best to turn saints of God away from their first love. The enemy is doing all that he can to discourage us.
But as long as we got the word of God, amen, somebody, the word cuts long, short, and wide. The word can cut so precisely, the double-edged sword don't miss. Ain't no devil in hell bad enough to take down the word of God. Y'all better get excited about that. I don't care how many gun stores you show up to, how many bulletproof vests you buy. Ain't nothing like this word of God. You can have access to this. But you know what you got to do? You got to speak his word. There's nothing more powerful than this word. You know what? I'm going to give you an illustration. The word of God can literally eat a grenade and floss with the grenade's pen. Amen, somebody? You better know what you got in your hand. You better know what's backing you. You have to understand that the word not only backs you, but I'm going to tell you something. In order for it to work, you have to live by the word. We can't just go out here just quoting scriptures that we done learned and not living by it. The enemy will eat you up. He know it's just mouth service, but there's an issue that you haven't resolved over here in this area, and if he can just push your button, you feel defeated. And he's stripping you of your power. That's why it's important to not only read the word, but you got to live by the word. There is not one person in the word of God that dedicated themselves to God that he did not defend. That's why when people say that they don't really believe in the Bible because it was rewritten so many times, first and foremost, I'm going to tell you this. That ain't the person that I'm going to call when I'm going through spiritual warfare. I'm over here pulling out a two-edged sword and they throwing Skittles at the enemy. But I need a blood-bought believer that believe in this word of God that will fight with me. Get you some prayer partners that ain't got time to question the validity of God's word because y'all too busy fighting in the spirit. But they will do everything what the word of God says all the way down to the last period in the book of Revelation. You don't need nobody that's questioning God's word. And even though we know it's already a fixed fight and God wins, the enemy show ain't bringing no butter knife to a gunfight. He's bringing everything that he can. Ask your neighbor. You strapped up? Turn to your other neighbor and ask him, can I call you when I need backup? Amen. Okay. So whether you are online or in this sanctuary, let's stand at this time. I told you I wouldn't be before you long. That's how sharp God's word is. Family, I want you to know that you have the most powerful artillery that exists. It shows you right here in this passage of scripture, Hebrews 4 and 12. This is worthy of mentioning again. God's word is alive and well. So if John 1 and 1 says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and we understand that God's not dead, he is yet alive, that means that God is the living Word, right? Oof. So don't give me no crystals. I don't need no horoscope readings, no star alignments. Don't tell me nothing about the retrograde. Give me the living word. Anybody know that you need the living word in your life? And if you represent the living God, will you just bless them right now? Will you shout with a praise right now and give them glory?
your way, have your way, Holy Spirit. Sharper than any two-edged sword. Robo Shaya did they see ababas. Thank you for your word, God. Thank you for all 66 books. If we did not have your word, God, we would be lost. It is a blueprint unto our lives. We don't have to fight as the world fights. This is your weapon. All these warfares that you're going against, here go your blueprint and your weapon. But if you don't sit down and take time and feast on this word, you won't understand the magnitude of power that you have in your hand. And so when, as you read it, this is why you have to understand it. It has to go down here. You got to have it in your heart, because if you don't have the physical Bible and you can't get to that phone app, you can have it in your heart. You can remember that God says that vengeance is mine. You can remember that I'm more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. You remember that I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Hallelujah. Let's just take a moment and allow the Holy Spirit just to rest. Because I believe the Holy Spirit is speaking. As you know, our worship leader, she's out, and we're going to continue to lift her up in prayer. But I'm always privileged to know what she's going to sing, and I just couldn't wait for her to sing this song, y'all. But we're just going to sing a couple of choruses. We're going to sing the chorus a couple of times. And it's a very familiar song to everyone. It's Fred Hammond, You Are the Living Word. And we're just going to sing the chorus. And if you don't know the chorus, let me read it to you. It says, Jesus, Jesus, that's what we call you. Manger born, but on a tree. You died to save humanity. You are the living word. Y'all ready? Let's sing it together. Jesus, Jesus, that's what we call you. Manger born upon a tree, you died to save humanity. You are the living word.
Jesus, Jesus, that's what we call you. Manger born upon a tree. You died to save humanity. You are the living word. Jesus, Jesus, that's what we call you. Manger born upon a tree, you died to save humanity. You are the living word. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Anybody know him to be the living word? Thank you, Jesus. He's our living word. Sharper than any two-edged sword. Thank you, Jesus.
Sent down the glory. Many think you were on earth a holy king, a carpenter, but you are the living
word. Come on,
word.
Family.
Come on. Many things you were on earth, a holy king, a carpenter. Come on, Houston, you can say it one time with us. Send down from golden. Many things. Come on, somebody say it. Now let's call it one more time and say it.
Come on, sanctuary. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say,
God's word,
your weapon. Turn to your other neighbor and say, God's word, my weapon. Let's bless God for the living word. Amen.
Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. You can do better than that. It's not about the messenger. It's about the message. Come on, somebody. It's about the message. The word. The word. It's the word. So you are the living word, whether you know it or not. When you read the word of God, when you read the scriptures, you become that living word. And you say, well, Pastor, what are you saying? Because what you read, you become. So as our dear sister was saying, if you're reading all the tabloids, that's what you become. That's what you begin to walk into and walk out in your life. But when you read the living word, that's what we call him. Come on. See, he died on a tree to save you and me. He became. That's what we call him. Jesus, Jesus. He was born in a manger. But died on a tree to save you and I, which is humanity. That is the living word. Come on, somebody. See, this is how we fight our battle. This is how we fight our battle with the word of God. See, when you're going through something, call his name. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. So if he died for you and I, if he died for you and I, that we might live. Ladies and gentlemen, we wouldn't be here today without him doing what he did. Come on. He's the living word. See, he chose you and I.
No matter where you find yourself,
so that people can see us. See, they can't see him, so he made disciples of us that we can see him and become the living word of God through our lives. Come on, somebody. Woo! Come on, lift your voice, lift your voice. The word has come forth. The word is alive and well. That's what we call him. Come on.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
See, you got to get to a place. You got to get to a place where you call on Jesus. Don't call Tyrone. Don't call Tyrone. Call on Jesus. See, Tyrone ain't paying his bills, so he can't answer the phone. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And you fool around and call Tyrone, he just might not be at home because he with his other boo. But when you call on the name of Jesus, when you speak the word of God, the living word, it becomes alive. So you don't have to worry about the line being busy. Call him up and tell him what you want. You don't have to worry about if God done paid his bill to stay in contact with you. He's the living word. He lives. Somebody tell your neighbor, he lives. And he lives within me. The word is alive and well, ladies and gentlemen. See, what we do on Sundays and Wednesdays, and we deliver the word so that can continually to be alive in you. But it's up to you to activate it. It's up to you to receive. Y'all come, y'all don't want to talk to me this morning. If you really understand, how many of y'all had to take tests in your days? You know how much time it took for you to study? See, y'all ain't playing. Y'all ain't saying that. You see, if you understood how much time goes into preparing a 30-minute message on Sunday morning, See, we have to live it. We have to make it come alive in our lives. So that when we stand up here on Sunday morning, that thing is already activated in our spirit. We've been living it. That's why we can speak with authority. That's why we can speak with confidence. That's why we can speak the word of God. Huh? It becomes alive. It's the word. Ladies and gentlemen, you can't get away from it. You cannot get away from the word of God. I heard my daddy say many years ago, come out with your hands up. You can't hide, sinner, you can't hide. I don't care how far you try to run away. See, y'all, I believe everybody in here, you grew up in church, and you hear some of the secular singers that say, oh, I grew up in church, but. And if you notice, they can't get away from it. It's still in their secular songs. When life happens, whether they go to the rock. And what is the rock? It's the word of God. Because they know that it is alive and well. He's the living word. He's the living word. Jesus. Every head bowed and every eye closed. If you are not saved, if you have not accepted the Lord as your leader of your life, this is between you and God. Slip that hand up. If you're a backslider, and if you were to die today and you don't know where you're going to spend eternity, you may think, I'm okay, I'm good, because you woke up this morning. Because you was able to walk and talk and you had food in the house. You had have a roof over your head. And you may, you know, Pastor, I'm good. Yes, You are. But where's your eternal soul? If you were to die today, where would your eternal soul be? Are you going to live eternally at the right hand of the Father? Or are you going to burn in hell? Because the word that the enemy has told you, it has hookwinked you and bamboozled you. What word are you listening to, ladies and gentlemen? What word are you listening to? Because it only takes one word to change your life. One word. And it's the word, the name of Jesus. If you accept him, Jesus, as the living word, your life will be changed and it'll never be the same. But if you deny to speak the word of Jesus and you were to die without speaking that name and without accepting that name into your heart, there's no gray area, ladies and gentlemen. You will die in hell and go to hell, and you will not spend eternity with the Father in heaven on the streets paved with gold. But you will be burning, gnashing of teeth, and you'll be wishing somebody can give you some water just to cool your tongue, but it'll be too late. If you are living a life of sin contrary to the word of God, now's the time. This is the moment, because tomorrow is not promised to you. Thank you, Lord. See, we become so complacent. We become so inundated with our day-to-day that we glance over the word of God. And I like the point that she made out was the fact of how when you take time, dive in, study to show thyself approved, that you're worthy, that your workmanship of the word, that's how you know your life is changing, because you're not living the same. Because the way you're living before you read the word of God, the way you live after you read the word of God, there should be a difference in your life. Somebody should tell a difference. Because you are applying the word of God for what you have read. It's going to cut you. And it's going to cut you in a good way if you accept it. But as it's cutting you, God is revealing things to you that you need to get rid of. In other words, when you cut something, it exposes the inside. It exposes the inner things that you didn't see, that you didn't know, that was hidden. But because God loves you so much, as he's exposing those things that he has cut you with the word, he's also mending your broken heart. He's healing that hurt place. Because worthy is the Lamb. It's not about the Easter bunny. Come on, somebody. But worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the Lamb. The word works if you apply it. this whole month, God has been speaking to us about his word. God has been speaking to us about his blood. Those are two subjects this month. God just, I'm sitting here, and as I hear our dear sister speak, God is saying, I have been giving y'all the word, and I've been telling y'all about the blood. But you can't get to the blood until you're cut. Y'all don't want to talk to me this morning. You got to get cut. I remember when I had and I'm going to let you go. The word has been gone, but God is just speaking. Somebody. My finger was swollen beyond measure. Couldn't figure out what it was. Went to the doctor, and they said, we got to prick it to get the pressure off of it. And so the first knife that they used, it didn't work. Because it wasn't sharp. It wasn't sharp enough. And the doctor said, that didn't work. And I'm looking. I said, well, now, Lord, my finger is swollen. It's big. It's throbbing. And you mean to tell me you got to get something that's sharper than what you've already used? And the moment that he switched, and just so happened, this particular instrument had two sides to it. And the point of it, it was so fine that you could barely even see it. But the moment that he pricked, the moment of the contact, the moment that he touched my finger, blood came streaming. And it began to just split. I said, oh, Jesus. But the moment that I saw the blood running down my finger, God reminded me. He said, this is how the word works. The word is here to draw the blood. The word is here to draw the impurities out of you. The blood is here to cover your sins. That's why he's got to cut you. And some of y'all, he's got to use a knife sharper. In other words, he's got to take you deeper in the Bible, deeper in the scriptures, because the milk ain't working for you. So he said, you know what? Let's go a little deeper. So he's got to get a little something sharper for you because you're not reacting. You're not reacting to the first word, to the first cut, to the first knife that was sharper. And some of y'all are in a place to where God has got to use the sharpest instrument to get your attention. But please understand, when he cuts you, he's healing you all at the same time. Yes. Yes. The word that has gone forth today, I don't know about you, ladies and gentlemen, but I receive it. Lord, cut me. See, y'all, don't play with it. Don't play with it. Because y'all be saying stuff, repeating after us. I done told you, we're in it. We live in this thing. Don't you play with it. Y'all hear me say that. Don't say it because I say it. Don't say it because Sister Kim said. Don't. You better know when you say, Lord, cut me. He going to cut you. And when he cuts you, don't get mad. When he cuts you, he's only trying to get you to a place that you don't even know that you need healing. And he's going to use the word of God. And it just may come from a person that you don't even know or realize. You're not going to always read it and reveal it. He's not always going to reveal it in the Bible. But someone that he will put you, that will cross path with you, will speak the word of God. And you may take it offensive. But God is saying, no, you didn't get it when you was reading it in the Word, so now I got to send a physical disciple, somebody that you can look at, somebody that you can touch, and give you the Word that I was trying to deliver to you from the Bible. Think it not strange. God will do whatever he needs to get your attention and to get the word down in you. Come on, somebody. I say this once again. Every head bowed and every eye closed. I don't know who that was for, but I'm just piggybacking off of the word that has gone forth today. See, God is talking to somebody. God is trying to tell somebody, change your life. Change the direction. The trajectory where you're going is going to lead you to hell. See, I can't sugarcoat it. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Because if you're not, God didn't say you had to be perfect. But he says, do what you know to do that's good and right. Because the things that you know that's good and right, if you don't do it, you're in sin. See, y'all take the word and justify it for it to fit your lifestyle. Y'all don't want to talk to me. God loves you, ladies and gentlemen. And God sometimes gives us the opportunity. You know, it's almost as if we were really pleading. And we will. Thank you, Holy Ghost. God says he's pleading. He's pleading. He's pleading. Because he don't want you to go to hell. The word of God and the blood of Jesus comes together to save us. One more chance. One more chance. You don't know if you're going to come back next week. You don't know if you're going to be able to log on next week. You better change your life right now. There's thousands and perhaps millions that are hearing the word of God throughout this world right now. There's no excuse. We're not sugarcoating anything. I'm just telling you what's right. I'm telling you what's going to happen to you if you don't accept the Lord as your Savior. You will die and go to hell. Don't wait until it's the moment. Don't wait until you're at the crossroads to where you are looking at life or death. Because you just might not have the opportunity to say, Lord, forgive me. And for him to say, I will remember you. Come on in. You might not. Because your death could be instant. So please understand, ladies and gentlemen, don't play with your soul. Don't play with your eternal soul. Don't play with your salvation. It's not about you, but it's all about Him. God is the living word. That's what the song says. He's an awesome God. If you're at home, wherever you are, make that your altar. If you're in this building, right where you are, right where you are, God is knocking at your heart. He's there. Are you going to let Him in? Or are you going to ignore the knock? Jesus took the fall for all of us. But above all, He loves you. Repeat after me. Repeat this prayer after me. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the cuts. Reveal to me the hidden things that can keep me out of heaven. Father, forgive me for my sins, willingly and unknowingly. Cover me with your blood. Let your word be saturated into my spirit, that my life will change, that the word will work when I apply it. Help me to speak your word. Help me to walk in your word. Repeat this after me. Father, I can do all things through Christ that gives me strength. Without you, I can do nothing. It is through the word. Come on, repeat after me. It is through the word that I'm saved. And from this day forward, Lord, I trust you. Lord, when you cut me, I know you're healing me. Because the blood still works in my life. The word still works in my life. In Jesus' name, I receive it. I believe it. I'm anointed by it. In Jesus' name. Everybody says, amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise right there. And now unto Him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh within you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon each and every one of you and give you peace that passes all understanding. And remember the message today. The Word. The Word. The Word. The Word is our sword. Speak the Word, and the Word will work for you. In Jesus' name. I love you all. Thank you so much for your coming today. Thank you for joining us online. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you.